Ilska is a novel about Agnes, a woman of Lithuanian descent, born and raised in Iceland, and her relationship to her husband, who is this kind of non-entity, this person without an identity, in a sense. And Agnes is obsessed with the Holocaust and these mass murders that happened in the town where she is from, and her great grandparents were on both sides of. And through that obsession, she ends up meeting Arnór, this rare thing, a sophisticated neo-Nazi and a student of history. And she's never really met a proper Nazi before, and he's never really met a proper Jew before, Iceland not having a Jewish population. So they end up having this strange sort of archaeological lust towards each other, in a sense. The idea came to me as I had this idea of a man who burns down his house and leaves the country, and sort of to answer the question, why did he do that? And from that point on, sort of things started unraveling, and the story started showing. And actually, Agnes took over rather quickly as the main protagonist. I was very interested in writing a sort of what I've called an honest political novel, because I have big problems with the political novels as a genre, because it does it's a very manipulative form, and I wanted to make a non-manipulative book which also entailed that it needed to be confrontational, in a sense that you would have to confront it, you would have to sort of almost engage in a dialogue with it, which was the idea, and which is also why large parts of it is written in a form of sort of almost rhetoric or essayistic, because that was sort of having the book have its own character, or being its own character within and having its own almost personality, kind of. Living in Iceland, you feel like you're living on a rock, well, in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, which you are doing, in fact, and it does feel very often, even from me, that it's from there, Iceland feels almost like it's not a part of the world, that it's this Neverland which has nothing to do with the history of the world. And when Icelandic people think about World War II, we think about sort of rock and roll and pantyhose brought by the US military. And we think about Iceland actually stopping, not being a developing country anymore and becoming a rich country, which is what happened. And it's almost like this adventurous feeling of it. Because it is, but then sort of when you start looking at it and looking at the sort of the facts of the matter, of course Iceland is a part of the world, and I wanted to, in a sense, to write Iceland into that story. I wanted there to be a history of Nazism in Iceland and a history of racism in Iceland, and this whole, because we were in the middle of this nationalistic fight, actually, the fight for independence. We got independence in 1944, and we always have this, this elf image of ourselves, that we are these sort of innocent little cute creatures, whereas the fact of the matter, we're not demonic, of course, but it's the fact of the matter is we're a part of the world, and for me this is was very important in the book to have it, to make these connections, to connect Iceland to the biggest historical thing in our times somehow. I think the majority of Icelandic novels and art in general, at least narrative art, tends to focus on the particular national identity, sort of in what ways it is special, what is being Icelandic, sort of in this very demarcated way, and this sort of with these very clear borders. And I mean, but of course, there are writers that have traversed those lines. It's not done very often. I very often get the feeling that most Icelandic novels are actually about mountains and sort of these very sort of these very nationalistic symbols of ours often in a comical but in a very non-ironic way, sort of in a very passive way actually of dealing with the national cliches of Iceland. I would recommend a book called, in English, called Senselessness by Horacio Castellanos Moya, which is this. It's a book about a man who is proofreading and this very long document of a massacre of Indians in, which is in a country which is probably Guatemala, but I don't think it's mentioned. He grows this very obsessive relationship to the text and starts sort of finding the beauties in it, sort of, and finding the beauty in the language of these complete atrocities. And you see him, you feel him spinning completely out of control. It's a very uncomfortable book, but also in the same way, you end up having almost the same relationship to the book as the proofreader in the book has of the text in it, and it creates this meta narrative of pain and the fascination of pain, which I found was absolutely amazing.